In less than 9 months, Arizona will celebrate its 100th birthday. In each month leading up to the state centennial, Horizon takes a look back at what made Arizona what it is today. Tonight, we take a look at military history by visiting a place that specializes in the subject. Arizona Military Museum has been around for about 30 years. It's housed in an historic adobe building located at the Papago Park Military Reservation in Phoenix. Visitors get a tour of military history from long before Arizona was a state to the current war on terrorism and all points in between. Here now to tell us more about the museum is Joe Abodeely, a retired U.S. Army colonel, Vietnam veteran, and director of the Arizona Military Museum. Good to see you. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me. This is a great opportunity to tell people about the museum.
Well, tell us about the museum. What's it designed to do?
Well, it's designed to inform people about the military history of Arizona and Arizonans who served in the military, from the conquistadors, as you pointed out, all the way up to the modern wars, Operation Enduring Freedom, Iraqi Freedom, Desert Storm. We have a display for women in the military. We have a Medal of Honor display. And, of course, we cover from the conquistadors, the Spanish colonial period. We cover the U.S.-Mexican War, early Arizona. After early Arizona, the Indian Wars. You know, everybody's seen all cowboy Indian movies, Apaches and Geronimo, Cochise, Nane, Akashe. And then we even do the Rough Riders in Arizona. Everybody forgets, or maybe they don't know, those Rough Riders that Teddy Roosevelt was talking about were from Arizona. And then we go right after that, we have a display relating to On the Border, a guy named Pancho Villa raided Columbus, New Mexico. Pershing's expeditionary forces went and chased him, and that's when the Arizona 1st Infantry Regiment became the 158th Infantry Regiment, was sent over to France in World War I as fillers, came back, they trained, and then they became the famous Bushmasters, 158th Regimental Combat Team, who was MacArthur's point element in the islands. Arizona's got a fantastic military history.
Well, talk to me now about who operates this museum and how the thing is paid for.
Well, I'm glad you asked that, because we're so proud of this. We were incorporated in 1975, but we actually put the museum together, actually opened in 1981. Our board and I were elected to do all this in 1980. Our board are our docents. We run it. None of us get paid a penny. Nobody has a paid salary. We do all that. Funding, we get no funding except the guard is gracious enough to give us the building and the utilities. And so when I say we don't get anything, that's a lot. But we operate it. We clean it. I'm the president, and if you come down on a weekend, you'll see me sweeping the floors and pounding things in the nail, and all my other board members do the same thing.
We were looking at some of the things that are in the museum right now. What do you have there, and do you have, like, special one-of-a-kind sort of stuff?
Oh, we have uniforms, we have weapons, we have machine guns, we have rocket launchers, we have some very esoteric, very specialized stuff. And we get them from, people will come on in. I remember early on, World War II guy would come on in and hand his grand rifle. Or he'd bring in a Japanese flag with his all signatures, you know, of all the people, the family. We also get weapons assigned to us. I sign for them from the Center of Military History. We're a certified museum by the Center of Military History and by the Arizona Historical Society. And we're an official Arizona Centennial Legacy Project.
Talk to me now about, you referred to this earlier, but there really is a story here regarding the building itself. This is a historic building, is it not?
The building, it's on the historic register. It took us a long time to get it there. It was built in 1936 to 37 by Works Project Authority, one of those public works projects that people talk about and hint about. I'm old enough to probably say, you know, I wish they'd bring that back. And when we get the old people come on in who have even more gray hair than I do, I don't have to explain what WPA is to them. But they built it. It's an adobe building. The walls are about 2 feet thick. And I'm telling you right now that when all the rest of these new buildings are dust, that adobe building's still going to be standing. It was the building that where the motor pool was and the prisoners of war, the German Nazi U-boaters who were captured and sent to the prisoner of war camp on 64th Street and Oak, they were brought over and they worked on the diesel engines.
And I'm sure there are some people right now watching this program saying, German POWs, 64th Street and Oak? Yes, indeed. That's quite a story out there.
Real story, real story. They must have really made somebody angry that these guys who might have been raised in the Alps and the cold weather climate were sent to Arizona.
The designation, the museum is designated as an Arizona Centennial Legacy Project. What does that mean?
That means that we are doing things consistent with what the Centennial Program is, and that is to portray things relating to the history of Arizona. There's one section I left out, and I need to mention this to you, and that is we have one room, about 3,000 square feet, which is dedicated to the Vietnam War. This is very important because most living veterans today are Vietnam veterans. I've spent my adult life dealing with World War II, Korea, all that other stuff. Now, we Vietnam veterans are those old guys that we used to make fun of, okay? And the Department of Defense has a project called the 50th Commemoration of the Vietnam War Project. Arizona has passed a resolution making March 29th Arizona Vietnam Veterans Day. And in conjunction with the Department of Veterans Services and their staff, we are going to put on a dinner in October 22nd, honoring Arizona Vietnam veterans.
So talk to us now about future plans for this museum. It sounds like things are expanding, or are they? Are you pretty much built out here? What's going on?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Somebody mentioned that to me the other day. We, like all museums, have used all of our space. Some people say, Joe, why don't you just expand? I says, well, right now what I think I'd rather do, because we can't expand, we don't have that kind of funding, and money is tight for other things, and as you know, the arts usually get the least of funding. And so what we do is we get donations, we give our own money. The Department of Veterans Services has helped fund this event, this dinner we're going to put on, and we're very thankful to Colonel Joey Strickland, retired, and his staff who's helping us with that because they gave us the money to put this on. But I think what we want to do is just be a vehicle for people to come on in and honor veterans of all these wars. And as I said, the Vietnam veterans are now those old World War II veterans. They're around, and this is the only museum in the state that has a 3,000 square foot room honoring Vietnam veterans. We have a UE in the middle of the room, a UE
yes,
helicopter.
Yes.
We have a ZPU-4, you know, those four anti-aircraft. We have a gun jeep in the middle of the room. We have uniforms. We have AK-40s. It's really a neat museum.
Hours and location.
It's located at 5600 East McDowell. You go in the main gate of the Papago Park Military Reservation. You enter off of Bushmaster Boulevard. About 5600 East McDowell would be the best way to get in there. And we're open every Saturday and Sunday from 1 to 4, but we're going to be closed June, July, and August. You're going to have to wait till September again. This rest of this month are open, but then June, July, and August, we're going to be closed during the summer.
So Saturday and Sunday, get on over there.
That's it.
Last question. We've got a minute or so left here. What do you want people to take from a visit to this museum?
That's an excellent question. I want them to appreciate the service of all of these people who have served their country honorably. A lot of people say they care about veterans. I always tell my board, I don't really believe that's true. And I'm a veteran. I'm a Vietnam veteran. And I'm proud of that. But I've tried to make people aware of the service of veterans, and I want them to be aware of this great history, this really colorful military history that has made the great state of Arizona.
A lot of folks are surprised when they go in there, aren't they?
Yes, they are.
All right. Joe, it's good to have you here. Good luck with the museum, and we'll keep in touch with you because we want to make sure that if these expansion projects ever do happen, we want to hear about them from you.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you for having me.
You bet. Coming up on Horizon, the Phoenix Coyotes have a home in Glendale next year, but after that, lots of questions remain. Arizona Republic reporter Rebecca Sanders has the latest. That's Tuesday at 7 on Horizon. And we do want to remind you that if you enjoyed tonight's program and would like to see it again, you can catch it on the web at azpbs.org/horizon. That same website will allow you to see what we've had in the past, what we plan for in the future, and again, an opportunity to review all of our programming. Again, that's azpbs.org/horizon. We'll talk coyotes and we'll talk recall elections tomorrow on Horizon, but that's it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.